I'm at the ZWO factory here in Suzhou, China. Let's go take a look.
So every ZWO product actually starts its life here. This is about 15 minutes away from the factory at the main ZWO offices in Suzhou. And here at the main office, a large team of engineers and product managers come up with the final designs. After any design is finalized, then the parts are produced in various places around China, including by third-party suppliers, and then shipped to the factory. The ZWO factory is a large place spanning two big buildings connected by a bridge. When parts arrive at the factory, they go through an initial quality control check before getting inventoried and then placed in this parts warehouse space for use on the assembly lines. Some parts, like the PCBs, have to be in a climate-controlled room where the humidity levels are regularly checked. There are so many different parts here. I even found parts for products that have not yet been released. Products are then assembled from the various parts. And throughout the assembly process, there are a number of different tests to make sure things are working as they should be. And then a percentage of each product line also gets a more thorough final QC check to make sure there isn't some systematic flaw. After a product is assembled and tested, it goes to packaging before being shipped out to distributors. And the factory typically runs a normal 8 to 5 business hours because they don't have a night shift. ZWO wasn't always this big. In fact, it started with just one employee, the founder, Sam Wen. I was able to sit down with Sam and ask him a few questions about the history and the future direction of ZWO.
How long was the company just you before you hired an employee?
Oh, I think from 2008, 2009, and 2010, and 2011.
Okay, yeah, the first 4 years.
Okay. Yeah, 4 years. Yeah. So I just enjoy the hobby because I did not start the ZWO company. Mm-hmm. I just be a dealer, mm-hmm. yeah, and sell products so you can have more time, more money to invest on your hobby.
Sure. How did you start building the company? Like, how did you start finding employees that sort of understood what you were doing and wanted to work on an astronomy company?
This is very hard, actually. Yeah. At the first beginning, usually you will choose your friends uh-huh. or relatives.
Yeah.
It's very hard to find the right people.
Mm-hmm.
It's very hard to find the right product manager.
Sort of jumping forward to today, the ASIR, you said that was your idea. Are all the products coming out now, or a lot of the products still your idea? Is that how it starts, or do you get ideas from your employees for new products?
No, we have many product managers now.
Uh-huh.
So they will get the idea from customers' feedback.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, you see that we have BBS,
mm-hmm.
we have Facebook group, and also we read a lot from the cloud night.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so you have many feedback channels.
Mm-hmm.
It's very hard for them to decide which requirement is real requirement.
Yeah, yeah.
You can't do all the things.
Sure.
Yeah, so you have to choose the most important part.
Tell me about the development of the your first mount, the AM5.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, how did that... what was the development process like for that one?
Yeah, actually, that's our hard time.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, for a month, because we used to do cameras and ASIR, but we want to do a month because I think we started the project from 2019.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because we saw the EV scope on Kickstart.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think the image scope was there at 2018.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so we think the smart telescope is the future.
Mm-hmm.
But we only have camera, we only have ASIR, and we don't have much, we don't know to control
yeah, yeah.
the telescopes to get a good image. So we start a project and we wish to build the mount by ourselves. Yeah. So at first we tried to make the mount with the traditional way, with wool and gear. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's very hard. Yeah, so make many, many samples and think the final mount we call the M5, but there is M1, M2, M3,
M4. Oh, I see. Yeah. Different prototypes.
Different prototypes. At last, we use the harmonic driver to make the M5. Uh-huh. Yeah, I think that is the best decision for us. Yeah, it's because it's very portable and no balance. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so very easy.
You said that you needed to sort of build the mount before mm-hmm. you could build the Seestar because you had no mount experience.
Yeah.
So I guess just tell me about the development of the Seestar. Did you have to build a whole new team to do a smart telescope, or did you take people from existing departments?
Yeah, we take people from the existing team. Uh-huh. Yeah, that is the hardest part.
Yeah,
because you employee have to keep learning.
yeah,
from planetary imaging to deep sky cameras and to SAR. And to mount and to see star, yeah. So this is not easy because, it integrated so many different kind of equipment, technologies together. Yeah. So this is very hard actually, mm-hmm. and this is our first time to make a such consumer product. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because we think it can be used not only by the astronomy enthusiasts, but also most customers who just have interest of astronomy.
What did you think of the reception of the Seestar? I mean, from my perspective, it seemed like it was immediately very popular. Were you expecting that, or did you?
We expected that, but it's not true.
Oh, okay, it's not true.
Yeah, it's not come true.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah, because I think the current customers are still those who already have a telescope.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Yeah, and they move from traditional telescope to smart telescopes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's not beyond of expectation. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And second, we still have to wait.
Yeah.
And we have to do lots of marketing to mm-hmm. reach to the people who have such interest.
Yeah, I guess, I mean, so do you think that for people who have been doing astrophotography with your products from before, do you think you will convince them to use smart telescopes more, or do you think you're trying to find a new market basically for smart telescopes?
I think I'm an example uh-huh. because I used to do serious astrophotograph of deep sky object imaging, and I'm fair. It's still very complicated, even with the help of SAR.
Yeah.
You have to assemble it together, you have to power up everything, you have to carry everything, adapters, cables.
Yeah.
So it's still a little complicated for the customers. So actually, myself, I usually travel with a Seestar. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's easy to carry and go.
Yep.
Yeah, so we visit the USA and we take it and just set it up and take the image of the sky. I think most of the traditional photographers maybe have the same experience as me. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think many old astrophotographers, they don't have the energy to carry very heavy equipment.
Yeah, so.
Lightweight should be the future. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The challenge I see with smart telescopes is that if they get more and more advanced, and let's say I buy a $2,000 smart mm-hmm. telescope, mm-hmm. if the technology becomes out of date, or I want to change my field of view, like if a new mm-hmm. sensor comes out, I can't afford to buy a new smart telescope mm-hmm. every 2 years, right? Mm-hmm. but I could maybe just upgrade one component in my imaging rig. So how do you get around that hurdle, for customers?
Yeah, I think that is also one very important factor. Yeah, if the decision to make such component telescopes or just the all-in-one telescopes.
Yeah,
we used to think like to make a camera module to integrate it with a smart telescopes, but it's very hard.
Yeah, just like something that could just like click in. Yeah,
you can remove the camera, you can exchange the filters, but the control is still very like the traditional ways.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so it's not just a grab and go telescope.
Right.
Yeah, so that is different from the goal of a smart telescope, I think. So I think a good smart telescopes should be easy to control, maybe even just with your voice.
Mm-hmm.
You should tell it, I want to see the Andromeda galaxy and it will point to, it will go to the Andromeda galaxy automatically and take the image. Yeah, so I think integrate all see together is a better way.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but just like I used, maybe it become expensive and exchange become hard.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I think it maybe won't become so expensive.
Okay, so you're hoping that even with bigger Seestars maybe in the future, you're going to try to keep the price pretty low.
Yeah. Okay. Because you will have lots of customers than before.
Yeah,
because I saw that many people say the astronomy equipment is very expensive compared with other stuffs.
Sure.
That is because we have very few users.
Well, thank you so much, Sam, for sitting down with me. I really appreciate
it.
Other than touring ZWO, I was honored to be a guest speaker at the 7th Yangtze River Delta Star Party, which is the largest star party in China. It was great to meet so many enthusiastic Chinese astronomers and connect with Chinese astronomy manufacturers who were exhibiting here. You can think of the Yangtze River Delta Star Party as a slightly smaller version of NEAF and NEAC here in the United States. There were a number of indoor presentations and many exhibitors to talk to. The main difference was the exhibitors were all set up outside, and so they could show off their telescopes and other gear at night as well. We were lucky to get a nice, clear night for the Star Party. Other than Maggie and me, ZWO also facilitated travel for Yuri Beletsky, who gave a great talk on imaging in the Atacama Desert. After the Star Party, Yuri, Maggie, and me were joined by Una and Lillian from ZWO on a tour of the Shanghai Astronomy Museum. This museum, which opened in 2021, was not only the best astronomy museum I'd ever been to, but probably the most impressive science museum I'd ever seen. If you were visiting Shanghai, I'd highly recommend securing tickets for this museum in advance. After the museum visit, Maggie and I did some tourist stuff on our own in Shanghai and Beijing. And we had a great time in China. We enjoyed the food, the culture, and of course, all the people that we were able to meet. I'd highly recommend a visit to China if you get the chance, and I want to thank ZWO for facilitating my visit. Well, till next time, this has been Nico Carver, Clear Skies.